Hey, Dr. C here with you. So how much iodine do you need exactly? It's a good thing. It's not a magic tonic. It's also not a villain. It's a mineral with an exacting requirement. And I want to give you the full answer on how much you need to have your best health. Quick summary, the ideal amount for adults with normal thyroid function is between about 50 and 200 micrograms per day. Those who are pregnant and lactating need different amounts. Those who wish to reverse thyroid disease may need different amounts. And many people have a broader iodine tolerance. They actually can do okay with more or less, but they're not the ones who are prone to thyroid disease. All right, so hang on, let's go deep and sort out your best iodine levels. So for starters, iodine is a mineral and it's a necessary part of forming thyroid hormone. So in its absence, there's just not enough of the building block. Iodine is a pretty incredible element. And of all the elements that we use nutritionally, zinc, calcium, iron, to name a few, iodine is in a place by itself. And I'm doing this gesture like where it is on the periodic table. It's by far the highest energy element in terms of the number of electrons and protons. And it's by far the most chemically reactive. So it's powerful stuff. It's kind of like, imagine like holding a smoking cauldron with a long pair of metal tongs and big thick leather gloves. That's how your body manages iodine. And to be really precise, there's a version called iodide that's less reactive. And that's how it enters our bodies, but we concentrate it in a few spots like in the thyroid. And there we convert it into iodine. And it's so reactive it makes these high energy bonds and forms thyroid molecules. And just a fascinating thing, in the distant past, we think iodine was one of the molecules that gave rise to life as being potential. So it turns out that iodine was probably necessary for any living things to metabolize in an atmosphere that contained oxygen. And over time, organisms came to have complex proteins they used to store iodine and have a safe place to put it, where it wasn't so dangerous. And those complex proteins became the precursors to thyroid hormones. And the earliest organisms, they were only getting those proteins from things lower down in the food chain. They couldn't always make their own. But they developed the capacity to make their own. And as we were no longer in the ocean, we developed the capacity to store these complex proteins. And thus was the whole thyroid hormone synthesis and storage developed. That's where it all came from, was all around, where can we put this iodine? Like some safe place to sock away the iodine. And that's how it all emerged. So what we've learned now in the recent past, we've known forever that nutritionally it's required and too little is bad. We've also known forever that iodine can be toxic. So there's like the old iodine bottles that have the skull and crossbones on them and they say poison. Well, that's for a good reason. Many people died from iodine overdose. So in a case of overdose, what happens is that there's so much of it that that iodide turns into iodine, even if the body didn't mean to. So we've got this range where there's too little. We've got this range where it's about right. Then we've got excessive. And at the excessive range, there's enough there to where inside the compartments where the body wants iodine, it can build up to too much. Then we've got toxic. And toxic is where there's so much that it's harmful even outside those compartments. And that's where it hurts the kidneys and the liver and the other organs. That's pretty unusual. We don't see that often. But what we now know is that for many people, the sweet spot is a narrow sweet spot. And they can easily get out of that, especially now on the higher end of that range. And so I'm going to share some charts and some documents here in the associated blog post that'll give you a lot more granular specifics. The first one's going to show daily targets, you know, recommended daily targets. And these are really good targets. We hear discussions that we'll talk about RDAs being insufficient or whatnot. This is a pretty good one. And we've got a lot of evidence looking at how much iodine is good and, you know, when you've got too much and when you've got too little. So it's coming into us from this larger iodine cycle. And this is a lot like the water cycle. So it ends up getting trapped in the oceans. And that's a place where it's the most inert. There's about 50 to 60 micrograms of iodine per liter of seawater. And from there, it's taken up by living things. It concentrates higher up the food chain. It's also built up to pretty high amounts in some sea vegetables. You know, these are things that have to be able to live even in an iodine environment and not be destroyed from it. So they're able to metabolize it. But it also seeps into soils in areas that are close by the ocean, but most of it comes on the land from rainwater. You know, the water from the ocean evaporates, goes in the sky, drops down the land, and that brings iodine to the soils. And so in general, areas closer to the ocean have more iodine in the soil, but there are some exceptions. There are areas to where the water that hits the soil is not the water that was straight from the ocean, that it was circulating longer beforehand. And then from the iodine in the soil, it comes into plants, comes into animals, and we access it that way. And there's differences in that because some soils are quite low in iodine. And by and large, most human societies, they adapted to what was present. Some societies had so little that they would see diseases, especially amongst children. The diseases of deficiency didn't affect adults as much, but they would affect children. The children could have their thyroid enlarge, they could be born without good thyroid function, or they could even be born with cretinism, which was a severe form of an iodine deficiency. So yeah, in areas of severe deficiency, we would see higher rates of disease, especially amongst children. And then we got some parts of the globe to where the intakes were a lot higher. You know, areas that were coastal, that relied heavily upon sea vegetables and seafood. And again, mostly people could adapt. You know, over time, big enough swaths of time, most people can adapt to a broad range in iodine. Not so much individual people can adapt per se, but more so their group can adapt in that those that have the traits that allow them to survive at a different iodine level, they're more apt to survive and reproduce. And so their genes tend to take over. So over long periods of time, we can adjust to a big range in intake. But if our intake changes within someone's lifespan, people have differences in how well they tolerate that. And by and large, those that don't tolerate that well are those who are prone to go on to develop thyroid disease, you know, a real strong connection that way. Now, there's how much iodine you consume and what your iodine balance is. And we'll talk about both of those. So iodine balance is a big picture concept about whether your levels that are stored inside your thyroid are steady, increasing, or decreasing. And it's a worthwhile concept because in a lot of ways, it's hard to measure iodine exactly, but we can get a sense of what that balance is. And we've learned about that by looking at people that do iodine uptake scans. So there's medical tests in which people absorb iodine, and then we use radioactive versions of that to see where it went. And someone has to be iodine hungry, so to speak, for that to work well. And we know that there are certain ranges in which they take it up well and certain ranges in which they don't. And we now know those ranges of good iodine uptake are also those ranges where the thyroid can fix itself. So yeah, there are some good ways to gauge someone's overall iodine balance. And as a generalization, someone is in that sweet spot to where they can reverse thyroid disease when they're somewhere under 49 micrograms of iodine per gram of creatinine in their urine. So that's the way we gauge that. I'll talk a lot more in depth about iodine testing in another video, but yeah, we can know about that part pretty well. And also I'll talk about iodine inventory. So there's a good tool you have access to. You can go to iodine inventory and you can gauge what your intake is by putting in your foods, your supplements, the amounts and things like that. And that's the most accurate way to see how much is there in the body. The commonly available tests that are done are really good tests for populations, but they fluctuate so much, they're not meaningful for one person. So with population studies, groups like the World Health Organization, they've looked at just every population on the globe and tracked what are the average levels of urinary iodine and what are the rates and types of thyroid disease. And they've taken that and identified these very distinct six different iodine levels, they've called that. I've got a chart of this in the blog as well. So the first level, that's been called severe iodine deficiency. And this is a tragic state. This is where we see those things that I mentioned before, like goiter can be prevalent, congenital hypothyroidism can happen. And in the past, cretinism could occur as well. This is at the lowest end of iodine intake. And this is occurring on diets that are generally devoid of any food variety at all. They're often diets that are just nothing but one starch monocrop, like rice-only diets or corn-only diets. They're just not nutritionally complete, and this is not their only nutritional deficiency at that level. At this point, we now are happy that there are no nations on planet Earth that are at this iodine level one, that condition has been eradicated as of 2014, so huge cause for celebration. Not that many years ago, there was over 100 nations that were at this level, but now none are. Next up, we have iodine level 2. This is called mild iodine deficiency. And here, we do still see some higher rate of goiter amongst children, but we see less rates of thyroid disease amongst adults. And this is between about 20 and 49 micrograms of iodine per liter of urine. And this is a level that now is also quite uncommon in the globe. We have only a handful of nations that are at this level. Next up, we got level 3. This has been called moderate iodine deficiency. Now, this is kind of counterintuitive, but the data has shown that we do see slight elevations of goiters sometimes in children, not always, but this is where adult thyroid disease can often reverse. So this is not a long-term level to be in, but this is the window in which we can reset thyroid function. So this is where you're in a negative state of iodine balance. Basically, the amount of iodine coming in is less than the amount trapped inside your thyroid. And it turns out thyroid disease is driven by too much of this, volatile free radical generating iodine bouncing around the thyroid and never getting a chance to get out. You know, your thyroid can only release iodine when it's packaged up in thyroid hormones, or just a few specks outside of that called the non-hormonal iodine. But you can only get rid of so much thyroid hormone, otherwise there's too much of that. So when your daily iodine intake is even, not all that high, but above some threshold, you can never get rid of the excess. And there might have been just one window of time in which you were getting way too much, but that too much is still there, and you haven't gotten rid of it all. So it takes being in this window of less to where you can reverse that whole process. And that's what's occurring at this level 3. Next up, we've got iodine level 4, also called iodine sufficiency. And by and large, this is the target for non-pregnant, non-lactating adults. And we see lower rates of thyroid disease occurrence here. So not so much reversal of existing thyroid disease, but low rates of thyroid disease onset. And this really is square within the recommended daily intakes for non-pregnant adults. Above this, we have what's called above sufficiency, or iodine level 5. And here, we start seeing thyroid disease go up. We'll see iodine-induced hyperthyroidism. We'll see autoimmune thyroid disease more common. Goiter starts to get more common. So how bizarre is that? When you're low by a little bit, there's more goiter. When you're high by a little bit, there's more goiter. And this is where it starts to pick up again. And hypothyroidism starts to elevate at this point too. And again, this is not for everyone. There are many people to where they can be at this level and be perfectly healthy, have no problems at all. But they're not the ones prone to thyroid disease. Those prone to thyroid disease, this is why. Once they get into this window, this slight excess, they start running risk for having complications. And that's the iodine paradox, is that all these things and also more conditions like subclinical hypothyroidism, thyroid cancers, these can emerge at just slight excesses. It's not massive, whopping, weird, alien, toxic amounts. It's a little bit extra. Above here, we've got level 6, which is called iodine excess. Now, this is an overt excess. And here's where diseases pick up quite consistently in populations. And this is generally above 300 micrograms per liter in the urine. In most cases, that's the same as about 300 micrograms per day daily intake. And that's not all that much. It's easy to get there when you think about how much we see in processed foods, the erratic amounts that are found in multivitamins. It's not hard to get there at all. So quite simple. And the thought is, how do you know what your current intake is? The best thing there is really thinking about this iodine inventory quiz for you. There are other tests, which I'll talk about, but the simplest thing is just taking the inventory. You can get a good sense on what your current levels are. But what's interesting is that your current levels don't predict whether or not you can benefit by a thyroid reset. So if you have thyroid disease, even if it doesn't seem like you're getting too much iodine right now, you still may be someone to where your thyroid function can improve. And we've seen this from the studies of thyroid disease reversal. They showed that pre-diet iodine levels didn't predict who would be successful. But of those who would not respond to the diet, by and large, you could see that post-diet iodine levels could explain that. So nearly all people that did not respond to modulating their iodine, they were found to still be at a very high iodine level. So it doesn't really help to check before you get going, but if afterwards you're not responding, that can be worthwhile. And the thyroid program talks about that too. So your easiest first action step is getting an iodine inventory, seeing what your current levels are, and seeing if this could be a way to help you reverse existing thyroid disease. If you're free of thyroid disease, you know, stay at that level 4 portion. Stay at iodine sufficiency. It's healthy. We want some. It's not a bad thing. And most can stay stable at that. But if you've got existing thyroid disease, getting to that reversal window has a great chance of helping. And by helping, it can mean your thyroid can grow new cells. Your thyroid can make new hormone. Now, if your thyroid is gone from surgery, or if it's highly shrunk and it's been down for years and years and years, it may not regrow, but there's still benefit because we see that that excess iodine state also makes your thyroid not respond to TSH. Your thyroid won't even try to work. And it also makes your cells block thyroid hormone and not respond to them. So even if you are to be on thyroid medication long-term because of surgery, you can get more benefit from less medication by getting yourself to that healthier state. So you can do better. This is a safe way and it's an easy way to help a lot. All right, Dr. C with you. Take great care. I'm so excited to share this message with you. It's an awesome thing. It's so hopeful. I'll talk with you real soon.